Hi friends, hope you are all safe at home. Please follow the guidelines given by the government with respect to corona. And today's video is about the third battle of Panipat. We have in our earlier lectures spoken about the Maratha Empire. How did Shivaji and his father Shahaji, who was a Jagirdar of Pune and Bangalore, had established the Maratha Empire. We then spoke about the Peshwaship as well as about the royal state of Kolhapur. So we had discussed in the last class about Balaji Baji Rao, that is Nana Sahib, the son of Baji Rao first. And now we shall be discussing the third battle of Panipat. As we had already discussed in our previous lectures, that the first battle of Panipat, which was fought in 1526, was fought between Babur and Ibrahim Lodi. And Babur, after this battle, was able to establish the Mughal Empire in India. The battle is most probably known for the introduce of gunpowder. Actually, the gunpowder was introduced much earlier, but however, Babur had made use of gunpowder popular in Indian subcontinent. Second is the second battle of Panipat, which was fought on 5th November 1556 between Akbar and Hemu. Akbar being a minor, so as a result, his regent Bairam Khan fought the battle with Hemu, and Akbar became a victorious in that. And finally, we are coming to the third battle, which was fought in 1761. It was basically between the Marathas and the forces of Abdalis. So we can also say the Abdali forces are also known as the forces of Afghans, because Ibrahim Ahmad Shah Abdali or Durrani was a noble from Afghanistan. He was a ruler of Afghanistan. So before I start this, I would like to give a pretext to it. The soon after the death of Aurangzeb in 1707 onwards, the Mughal Empire started declining and the Maratha Empire started gaining prominence. It was under the Peshwaship of Balaji Vishwanath Bhat and Bajirao that new zenith, the new heights Marathas were able to achieve. But unlikely, the Mughals, they were having internal problems, they were having their disintegration, and there were lack of able Mughal emperors after Aurangzeb. So let us see the aspects of the third battle of Panipat. First, the first aspect, the first background. So as I have just now spoken, that Mughal Empire was becoming weak, and this weaknesses was shown in 1719 also. Please refer to this point number 3. The Mughal Emperor Farooq Sir in 1719 was murdered by the Maratha Peshwa Balaji Vishwanath Bhat. It was on the request of Sayyid brothers that Balaji Vishwanath Bhat had assassinated Farooq Sir. And soon after that, Sahuji's mother was also released, and in later terms, we will see Baji Rao first became the first invader to Delhi. Delhi was the power center of the Mughal Empire, and nobody had the daring to attack, nobody had that will to attack Delhi, but it was Baji Rao one who had attacked Delhi and had openly elucidated the weakness of the Mughal Empire. Soon after the 1737 attack of Baji Rao, it was Nader Shah who will be coming in 1739 and invading Delhi. So after the death of Aurangzeb in 1707, there were no strong and able Mughal emperor who can consolidate the empire, as I had already told. Both invasions of Baji Rao I and Nader Shah in 1739, Nader Shah was a ruler of Persia, that means Iran. Both the invasions took place during the rule of Muhammad Shah. Muhammad Shah is a Mughal emperor who was oftenly called as Rangila Badshah by the historians, because he did not bother about the administration of the Mughal empire. He did not have even time to wear his clothes. He used to come naked into the courtrooms. That is why he is often called as Rangila Badshah. Aage chalte hain, fir we will see that Nader Shah, he will come to he will first come to Afghanistan before attacking India. He's a ruler from Persia. The word Shah specifically the Shah Empire basically denotes the empire of Iran. However, in Indian subcontinent also we are using the word Shah. So the Nader Shah, before coming to India, attacked Afghanistan, defeated Ahmad Shah Abdali, and made Ahmad Shah Abdali as one of his slaves and made him join his military services. So it was in 1739 when Nader Shah had invaded India. So Ahmad Shah Abdali, he came along with Nader Shah, and he was amazed, astonished by seeing the wealth India possessed. Though Mughals were weak, but still India had that wealth. That is why there is a famous saying, Sone ki chidiya. India was always a Sone ki chidiya. So Nader Shah, he came in 1739, and a very small battle, that is called as Battle of Karnal, was fought between the Mughal forces of Ahmad Shah and Nader Shah, and Nader Shah was able to defeat Rangila Badshah in couple of hours, not even hours, I would like to say. And both of them, then they came to Red Fort. Nader Shah stayed in the Red Fort in the personal suit of the royal suit of the Shah Jahan, where the peacock throne and Kohinoor Heera, the Kohinoor diamond was kept. And when he went back, he took both the peacock throne as well as the Kohinoor diamond along with him. And when he was here, his army was ransacking the local markets. So there was a rumor which spread during that one night that Nader Shah has died. So the locals tried to overpower the outside soldiers, and they killed few of them. This news, it went to Nader Shah. He got annoyed and ordered a large-scale massacre. This kind of massacre was not evident in the history previously. He had assembled all the localites in front of the Red Fort and ordered massacre. So it was Nader Shah who had brought Abdali for the first time in India. And by 1740, we have seen two major invasions, one by Baji Rao and other by Nader Shah. And by 1740, Baji Rao was able to conquest most of the parts of the Rajputana, Malwa, and the Central India. He had personally brought the Malwa and Central India under the empire of Marathas, and he had forced the Rajputs to pay Chauth and Sardeshmukhi. So I have highlighted two kinds of taxes, Chauth and Sardeshmukhi, which I will be dealing in the later stage, but I would like to give you a small brief about it. The Marathas did not used to collect Chauth and Sardeshmukhi from their own territory. They used to collect it from outside their territory. In their own territory, they used to collect only taxes what they had levied. But Chauth and Sardeshmukhi was like an illegal tax. They were getting a protection money paid by the rulers of other kingdom so that Maratha invasions can be stopped. Maratha will not be invading those areas where they will be getting Chauth and Sardeshmukhi. Chauth means 1/4. So they will be given 25% of their revenue collected by the ruler of adjoining Maratha empire. Any ruler whose kingdom is adjoining Maratha empire. So in order to avoid any Maratha raid, he will pay 1/4 of the taxes to the Marathas. So Deshmukhi is an additional levy of 10%. So Baji Rao was successful either to conquest or to have the Maratha dominance extended to the Rajputanas. And soon after the death of Baji Rao, his son Balaji Baji Rao, also called as Nana Sahib Bhan, became the new Peshwa, and he died after hearing the news after hearing the sad news of the loss of Third Battle of Panipat and the killing of a lot of Maratha leaders. So, and So after Baji Rao won, Balaji Baji Rao became the new emperor. Similarly, after Muhammad Shah, the Rangila Badshah, after his death, so he did not have any legal wife. So there was a son from an illegal wife, Ahmad Shah, who became the new ruler, and he was there from 1748 to 54. So in 70, similarly, what had happened after Nader Shah left India, after few time in 1740s, Abdali had attacked the military commander of Nader Shah in Afghanistan, and he himself established an independent rule in 1747 in Afghanistan, which is also called as the Durrani Kingdom. So I have written in 1747, Ahmad Shah Abdali Durrani was able to throw away the military commander of Nader Shah from Afghanistan. He declared himself independent and established Durrani Kingdom in Afghanistan in 1747. So try to understand, I have made a small table. See, the Marathas, the center of power of this Peshwa was Pune. Like under the time of Sahuji, the center of power was Satara, but we have a Peshwas who had the center of power at Pune. And right now the Maratha Peshwa was Balaji Bajirao. And if we talk about the Mughals, after Ahmad Shah, we had Alamgir II. Alamgir II also had a very short region of rule. And then Shah Alam, he never entered in Delhi fearing the Abdali as well as his Wazir Imadul Mulk. And so he had crowned himself in Bihar. He never entered into the Red Fort in 1759. But in later stages, under the protection of Madhuji Sindhya, he again came back to Delhi. And the Durrani Kingdom was held by Ahmad Shah Abdali. So I hope now you are able to have a rough picture in your head that in central India, the Marathas are controlled by Peshwa Balaji Bajirao. And here we have series of Mughal rulers starting from Ahmad Shah Alamgir II to Shah Alam II. And in the Afghanistan region, we have Ahmad Shah Abdali. So, and apart with that, we will also study one particular map at Saharanpur, Muzaffarnagar, Ramnagar, Rampur, this area was called as Rohilkhand. Rohilkhand was ruled by the Rohilla leader Najibuddaula, and he was can claim his lineage from the old Afghans, that is the Lodis. Lodis who were defeated, Ibrahim Lodi who was defeated by Babur in the first battle of Panipat. So we see Ahmad Shah Abdali. He started invading India from 1748. Just soon after 1 year of his coronation, he started invading India. And from 1748 to 1767, he continuously invaded India. At least seven major invasions were there. So he, for the first invasion, he crossed Indus in 1748 and captured Lahore. And by 1749, he started invading Punjab and the whole region of Sindh. So now there is a now there will be a slight intelligence shown by the Mughal Emperor Ahmad Shah. Ahmad Shah was not a able administrator by himself, but he intelligently appointed Safdarjung as the new Nawab of Awadh. Safdarjung was also a wazir of Mughal wazir of Awadh. You can say he was now given a twin responsibility. A, he was the chief minister of Awadh, and B, he was the prime minister of the Mughal Empire. So he was often called as Nawab-e-Wazir since he holded two portfolio. So Safdarjung, he was a diplomat and he had a vision also. He made two Mughal enemies. He made two Mughal enemies fought with each other. So what are the two Mughal enemies? So the two Mughal enemies, as we have rightly said, we'll just draw a chart. The Mughal enemies at this time was A, the internal Maratha, major, I would like to say, major Mughal enemies. There were other also, but the major Mughal enemies was Maratha and Abdali. So he planned to confront both of them. Dono ko samne laake, dono ko ladwana chahta tha, apna fayda uthana chahta tha. Marathas ek taraf attack karte the, Abdali ek taraf attack karte the, and he wanted to have a shelter from Marathas. And when Marathas are getting overpowered, he would like to have shelter from the Abdali. So let us see. Safdarjung knew about the growing weaknesses of the Mughals. Safdarjung signed an agreement with the Marathas in 1752. Very important. He had signed an agreement with the Marathas in 1752 that Marathas will be responsible for protecting Mughal Empire from internal and external dangers. From internal and external. So there are some internal dangers also. Internal dangers are A, the cousins of the emperor, B, the Sikhs, the Jats, the Rajputana, who are also looking for an opportunity to remove the Mughal emperor, and they wanted to these internal powers, they wanted to be crowned themselves on the seat of Delhi. And similarly, the external threat was Abdali. So as a result of this agreement, the Safdarjung agreed to surrender Agra and Ajmer completely to the Marathas, and gave them the right to collect Chauth from Mughal areas that were Punjab and Sindh area. From the Punjab and Sindh area, Mughals would be able to collect the Chauth. So, and this was the area, Punjab and Sindh was the area from where the Abdali used to come to India. So that Punjab and Sindh area, they wanted to bring Marathas in confrontation with the Abdali. But cleverly, Safdarjung did not got this agreement ratified by the Mughal emperor, because he thought when Marathas will grow more or will become more powerful, and if the Marathas will start dictating terms, then they will go for the shelter of the Abdali, and they will say the Mughal emperor will have a face to show to the Abdali that I have not ratified it, it is my wazir who had ratified it. So it was a very clever move, I would like to say that. So I have elucidated the external danger and the internal dangers. The external danger was Abdali, and the internal danger was the Rohilla chiefs. As Rohilla chief Najib-ud-Dawla, he will be the agent of the Abdali in India, the Sikhs, the Jats, and the Rajputs. So the Rohilla chiefs will be the one of the greatest danger, internal greatest danger to the Mughal Empire. In 1752, the same year when the agreement was signed, Abdali invaded India for the third time, and Mughal Emperor had no option. He had to sign a peace treaty to see that Abdali does not move further. So he gave Punjab and Sindh forever to Abdali. On the other hand, Safdarjung, so very importantly, the Mughal emperor had handed over Punjab and Sindh to Abdali, and on the other hand, Safdarjung agreement gave right to the Maratha to collect Chauth from these areas. So as a result, Marathas and forces of Abdali will now face each other and would like to confrontate each other. So it hence bringing to the first direct action. In 1754, Safdarjung, the Mughal wazir, was killed. He was assassinated, and a new wazir was appointed, Imad-ul-Mulk. Imad-ul-Mulk in future will assassinate Ahmad Shah II, also his own Mughal emperor, and also the Alamgir II. Imad-ul-Mulk, he conspires and he writes a letter to the Maratha telling them about the fact that Punjab and Sindh, the Mughal emperor has given it to the Abdali. So he, through this letter, he was portraying that Imad-ul-Mulk is is faithful to the Marathas, but the Mughal emperor Ahmad Shah is not faithful to the Marathas. He has done a betrayal. So in order to gain the confidence of the Marathas, he wrote this letter purposely to the Peshwa. As a result, in 1754, Peshwa had sent a small contingent of army under Raghunath Roy, and he removes Ahmad Shah II and makes Alamgir II as a new Mughal emperor. So in fact, the new Mughal emperor, see what a dichotomy. The Marathas are now able to decide who is the next Mughal emperor. In 1757, again Abdali invaded India. And as soon as the information came that he is invading India, the Maratha army from Pune was dispatched under the command of Raghunath Roy. Raghunath Roy was one of the uncles Vishwas Rao. You may say he was one of the brother of Peshwa Balaji Baji Rao. So in the invasion of 1757, Abdali captures Red Forts, and he asks the new emperor Alamgir II that his agent, that is the Rohilla chief Najib-ud-Dawla, should be made as the military commander of the Mughal forces. Military commander is called as Mir Bakshi, and all the decisions taken by the Mughal emperor Alamgir II should also require a concurrence or ratification from the Rohilla chief. So Rohilla chief actually became the de facto ruler of the Mughal empire. So on the other hand, the army of the Marathas were moving towards the Delhi, and when the army of Marathas moved towards the Delhi, we had seen that Abdali was already has left, and Rohila was Rohila chief was there. So Raghunath Roy came, he removed Rohila chief, and he was going to punish him, but as he evaded the punishment, and Najibuddaulah ran away from the Mughal court in order to save his life. The Marathas in 1758, now the Marathas after reaching Delhi, they realized that they should teach a lesson to the Abdali. So in 1758, the same army under Raghunath Roy occupies Lahore, removes the governor of Lahore. The governor of Lahore and Multan was Taimur Shah. Taimur Shah was the son of Ahmad Shah Abdali. So it was a very big move. And Raghunath Roy, he wanted to show back to the Peshwa that he is an able ruler, so he should hand over the rule to him. He is much capable to ensure that the dreams and the vision of Bajirao first and Shivaji are met, that is the Hindu Patshahi is met, that the flag of Maratha Empire is even flying high at atop. So he captured Lahore, he removed Taimur Shah, and then he went up to the fort of Atok, and he hosted the Maratha flag. Now this, you understand, this Punjab is not Indian Punjab. This is the Pakistani Punjab, which is this portion of Punjab is right now in Pakistan. So he has occupied this fort of Attock and hosted his flag over there. So now the actual borders, Abdali and Marathas are confronted, and seeing the Maratha flag on the fort of Attock, Abdali took it personally, and which will later result into third battle of Panipat. And after removing Taimur, Shabji Sindhia was made as the new governor of Lahore. So I have written clearly. So this event was taken personally by Abdali, and Rohila chief Najibuddaulah added fuel to this agitation. So you can see Najibuddaulah like a chapluse, you know, who is always he cannot fight any battle on his own. He always requires the shoulder of some other person, but he is always ready to add fuel into any kind of agitation. So as a result, Abdali crossed Indus in 1759, which had resulted into culmination of the third battle of Panipat. So you now got the background. The background is that it was a dirty politics played by the Mughals, that in order to save themselves from the Abdali, they had signed an agreement with the Marathas, and the Marathas had a vision that they would like to reach to the Punjab. They were greedy enough to get, I should not call it greedy, but they had a vision to collect Chauth and Swadesh Mukhi from the northern areas, and Raghunath Roy, in order to fulfill the dreams of Shivaji and Baji Rao, wanted that Attock should be made a part of Maratha Empire. So this had brought Marathas and the Abdali into direct confrontation, and Rohila chief, since he was removed by Raghunath Roy, he also wanted to settle his personal scores with the Marathas. So now we are seeing that Abdali has crossed the river Indus in 1759, and the forces of Abdali were supported by the forces of Rohila chief Najibuddaulah. Now in this battle, there are two major things. We understood why this battle is, why the confrontation happened. But the major thing is that the Indian kings like the Jats, the Sikhs, the Sikhs, whom they will support, whether they will support this war or not, this is a big question. The other thing is the strategy or the wrong moves taken by the Marathas and why they lost this battle. So, as we discussed, the forces of Abdali and the Rohila chief Najibuddaulah, they started moving towards this joined hands, and they started moving towards Lahore and removed the small garrison of Maratha army and started moving towards Delhi. The news came to Pune that they assassinated the governor of Punjab, that was Scindia. So Scindia was assassinated, and this news reached Pune. So as a result, Balaji Baji Rao decided that they will confront the Abdali. He sent a large contingent of army, between ranging from 45,000 to 60,000 troops, to counter Abdali. This contingent, this Maratha army, was actually led by Sadashiv Rao, but on papers it was Vishwas Rao. Vishwas Rao was the youngest son, was a 12-year-old son of Balaji Baji Rao. However, on ground, the power was exercised by Sadashiv Rao Bahu. However, so I have written also, however, the military command of the Maratha army was given in the name of Vishwas Rao, a 12-year-old son of Peshwa Balaji Baji Rao. But on ground, the real commander was Sadashiv Rao Bahu. Along with Sadashiv Bahu, there were few very good warriors of the Maratha who accompanied him. One was Malhar Rao Holkar. Second was Madhaji Scindia. His father was killed. His father was the governor of Punjab. Gaikwad, Govind Pant Bundile, Shamsher Bahadur, the son of Mastani and Baji Rao, Suraj Mal, a Jat leader who initially joined but later withdrew his support from the Marathas, Ibrahim Gardi. Ibrahim Gardi was one of the able military artillery commander. He was trained by the French army. Remember, the French were also there. The Battle of Carnatic were fought there. The first battle, the second battle, and the third battle of Carnatic. So he was from the Nizam state. Ibrahim Gardi was originally from Nizam state. Whenever we are talking about Nizam, it is Hyderabad. So when the Marathas, they fought a war with the Nizam, so there was a peace treaty, and out of one of the condition of the peace treaty was that Ibrahim Gardi will be handed over to the Marathas, and he will be made as the artillery commander of the Maratha army. Now, try to imagine the size of the army and the organizations by these words. Now, Sadashiv Rao, he did a very big blunder. He encouraged the practice of ladies accompanying their husband to the battlefield. So this was a major drawback. So the army will be engaged in fighting, or will be engaged in taking care of their families. So the soldier is moving with the family. So this proved to be very suicidal, because it had adversely affected the mobility of the army. So this was one of the major drawbacks. And then Marathas were not able to gain the support of the local Indian rulers like the Rajputs and the Sikhs. Rajputs were simply annoyed because the Marathas were collecting Chauth and Sardeshmukhi from the Rajput areas. There was an exception. Sadashiv Rao ko laga ki yes, Rajputs can betray me, the Sikhs can betray me, but not Nawab of Awadh. The Nawab of Awadh that time, Awadh means Uttar Pradesh, the Nawab of Awadh was Suja Uddaulah, and he thought he will help and join Marathas in their war against Abdali. Since Maratha had earlier helped his father, Suja Uddaulah's father was Safdarjung, in battle with the Rohillas at Farukabad. So, but however, Sadashiv Rao Bahu proved to be wrong. In July 1760, the Nawab of Awadh, Suja Uddaulah, made a decision to join the Afghan, that is Durrani is Abdali and Rohilla coalition, as he perceived as this was the army of Islam. So it was actually Najib Uddaulah who made him understand, Suja Uddaulah, who had brainwashed him that you should fight for Islam, you should not fight for a non-Muslim, and he made him join the armies of Ahmad Shah Abdali. In 1760, the Maratha forces, when they reached Delhi, the Red Fort was emptied, the in 1759, as you are aware, the Alamgir II was killed. So the next Emperor Shah Alam II, he never entered the Red Fort. He crowned himself in Bihar. So in 1760, when the Maratha forces entered the Red Fort, it was fully abandoned. And over reaching there, Sadashiv Rao Bahu, he declared and he wanted that Vishwas Rao should be crowned and he should be made as a Raja of Delhi, as the Emperor of Delhi. On the other hand, Jat leader like the Surajmal thought after Marathas will fight the Abdalis, they will give Delhi to Jats. So this connotation resulted in Jats had withdrawn their support from the Marathas. However, initially Marathas had an upper hand. Marathas, the defense line between the Marathas and the Abdali was the Yamuna River. Marathas in the monsoon of 1760 fought two small battles, Battle of Kunjpura and Battle of Karnal, where they had easily defeated small forces of Abdali which and killed their various generals. The only defense between Maratha and the Abdali forces was the River Yamuna. So River Yamuna was the main defense. One side there was the army of Marathas, the other side there was the army of Abdali. So Abdali had crossed Yamuna in October. Why he crossed, he was very eager to cross Yamuna because he cannot tolerate that the Marathas were had killed lots of general of Abdali forces in Kunjpura and Karnal. They had assassinated lot of commanders of the Abdali. So as a result, he motivated his troops to cross Yamuna. And remember, in October, soon after the rainy season, the Yamuna will have high currents. But he took a calculative risk and he crossed the Yamuna. And he crossed and there were small battles. But the major battle, which resulted into Third Battle of Panipat, was in 1761. Finally, the battle took place on 14 January 1761, where Abdali became victorious. There was a good defense provided by the artillery of Ibrahim Gardi, but Abdali was able to broke it. Sadashiv Rao Bahu, Vishwas Rao, the child of Peshwa, the Ibrahim Gardi, lost their lives in the battlefield. Suja-ud-Dawla and his aristocrat, Suja-ud-Dawla is whom? Nawab of Awadh. And he had a feudal lord or an aristocrat. He is Kashi Raja Pandit. You can see, you can consider that Suja-ud-Dawla is the ruler of Awadh, and just below him there is a feudal landlord. His name is Kashi Raj. He was the Raja of Kashi. But the eyewitness to the war, these two were actually, they had given the army to the Durrani, their own army to the Durrani to fight the Marathas, but they were not full heartedly supporting this battle. So they were merely a spectator in this battle, and according to both of them, more than 50,000 Maratha soldiers were killed. Abdali, after the war, you know why 50,000? Because they were carrying their families, their wives and all those things, so the mobility was also affected. Now before this battle started, Sadashiv Rao Bahu, who was the in charge of the Maratha army, had spoken to Yashwant Rao Holkar. He said, if any problem happens, if any untoward incidents happen, Yashwant Rao Holkar should escape the battlefield with all the ladies and all the children. So he did it the manner what was told to him by Sadashiv Rao Bahu. Abdali, after the war, appointed Najib-ud-Dawla as the military commander of India. He appointed the military commander means he appointed the military commander of all the Abdali forces and the Mughal forces which were there in India, and Najib-ud-Dawla, the Rohilla chief, was made as a military commander. And he and on top of that, he had written a letter to the Peshwa demanding him money to hand over the martyred or the killed Maratha soldiers. So he did not wanted to give, he did not had that humanity also to give the bodies of Maratha soldiers or to have a decent cremation for them. So Suja-ud-Dawla and Raja of Kashi, realizing their mistake, they paid for all the bodies to the Abdali, and the Maratha soldiers were then cremated as per the rituals by Raja of Kashi. Malhar Rao Holkar fled away. So important, Malhar Rao Holkar fled away from the battlefield and gave shelter to few Maratha ladies who had accompanied their husbands. Similarly, Madhaji Sindhya, he was wounded, he was badly wounded, and he also escaped the battlefield after being wounded, and he took a shelter for a few time in Rewari in Haryana, and after some time he had re-established his kingdom at Gwalior. Then Balaji Bajirao, he died of shock when he came to know about this disaster of Panipat. He came to know that Sadashiv Rao Bahu is no more, his son is no more, and he died due to heart attack. And soon after that, Madhav Rao was made as the new Peshwa. I hope Third Battle of Panipat is clear to all of you. If you have any doubts, if you feel like asking anything, you can WhatsApp me. And